when paper is printable in perpetuity and not grounded to the gold standard or some other aspect, the thesis is not difficult to understand.
Hello there from Bedford in the United Kingdom, the Bitcoin mecca of the world. How are you all? Welcome to the What Bitcoin Did podcast, which is brought to you by the mighty Kraken, the best place to buy, sell and trade Bitcoin. I'm your host, Peter McCormack, and today I've got an interview with Gary V, where I am asking him his thoughts on Bitcoin. But before that, I've got a message from my amazing show sponsors. Okay, first up today, we are going to talk about BlockFi. And did you hear their big announcement last week? BlockFi is to launch a Bitcoin rewards Visa credit card in early 2021. This is something I've been quite excited about because you can stack sats with all your card purchases. So card users can earn a market-leading 1.5% rewards rate in Bitcoin on all card purchases. There is going to be a $200 annual fee, but you can earn a $250 bonus in Bitcoin after spending $3,000 in your first 3 months. So the waitlist registration is now open for all registered BlockFi clients. So if you want to join the priority waiting list, you do need to open up a BlockFi account. There is a public waitlist and that is slated to open in early January. So if you're interested in checking this out, head over to BlockFi.com, which is BlockFi.com. Also, let's talk about Kraken, my favorite place for buying and selling Bitcoin. And as you know, it is the only place I use for buying and selling Bitcoin. You want to know why, right? Now, firstly, they are consistently rated the best and most secure cryptocurrency exchange, and security is really important to me. They also have a best-in-class in customer service. So if you have an issue, whoever you are, wherever you are, whatever the issue is, they are going to help you get that sorted. And if you want to start trading Bitcoin, they have every tool you could possibly need. So whatever your level of experience, if you head over to Kraken.com, it could not be easier to sign up and start trading Bitcoin. They also have a beautiful mobile-first app, so you can buy Bitcoin on the go. And with their margin trading, futures, and OTC desk, Kraken has every option covered for you. There is no better place to trade Bitcoin. Find out more at Kraken.com or download the app. It's available for the iPhone and Android. Just search for Kraken Pro, which is K-R-A-K-E-N-P-R-O. Okay, so onto the show today, and I am joined by Gary V, where I set out to red pill him as I hadn't seen him talk too much about Bitcoin. But alas, this show did not go as I expected. Now, Gary does have an understanding of Bitcoin, and he has owned Bitcoin for quite some time, but he has largely stayed on the periphery and hasn't really gone down the rabbit hole. Now, in September, he was scheduled to talk at a BSV conference, but Bitcoin Twitter jumped into action, and once he found out what the event was about, he quickly pulled out. Following this, I reached out to him, and I was like, Gary, come on, man, come on the show, come talk Bitcoin with me, and he agreed. So listen, look, Gary is a very passionate person. He talks very fast and I wanted to steer the conversation in a certain way. But at times it got a little bit tricky as we were pushed for time. And unfortunately, we got cut off as Gary had to rush off to do something else. But he agreed to do a second show. So we've booked this in for January, where we will go back down the rabbit hole again. Also, in all honesty, I had a bunch of questions prepared, the areas I wanted to go down with Gary, but he, you know, rightly pointed out some issues relating if Bitcoin hits $100,000, you know, how will states respond? And you know what? I was not prepared for these questions, so I will have myself prepared again regarding this for January. But looking forward to doing it again with him, where we can do that and also get into some more niche ideas. Anyway, if you've got any questions about this, you can reach out to me. My email address is hello@whatbitcoindid.com. Also, if you want to check out Defiance, episode 4 of Chaos is out. Episode 5 is coming out on Thursday. Also, looking at 2021 plans, hoping to launch an email service, as well as potentially a third show. So that's pretty exciting. Outside of that, have a great week, and I will see you all on Friday. Gary, how are you, man?
I'm well, my friend. Thank you for having me on.
Hey, well, thank you for doing this. I know how busy you are. You're a very busy man. So listen, I know we've got a certain amount of time. There's two things I want to talk to you about. I want to talk to you about football. I want to talk to you about Bitcoin.
Let's do it.
Let's start with football. And there's two things I know about the Jets, right? Okay, firstly, I know you want to buy them.
Yes.
And then secondly, I don't know why you want to buy them because I know they suck.
They have not won a football game this entire season. They are 0 wins, 10 losses as of the moment we're recording this.
That's a record, right?
It's not a record. There are two teams in the American NFL football league that have gone 0-16. There's 16 games in a season. And there's one team when they used to play 14 games in the late 70s that was 0-14. However, in comparison to the two teams that went 0-16,
yeah,
they have been worse than those two teams in the first 10 games. So it has definitely been a challenge watching every single play, which is what I do. You know, picking up, knowing your accent and, you know, making some assumptions that there's some proper football fans listening. You know, I am an American football fan that looks more like a proper, you know, Premier League European football fan. I actually completely live and die with the New York Jets. Like, I'm in a worse mood this morning because they lost yesterday. Other than I actually want them to lose so that they have more leverage for the draft, which is how it works here.
Yeah.
You know, for me, they represent America. I came to, you know, I was born in the Soviet Union. I didn't know how to speak English. And one of the first things that really Americanized me was American football and the Jets. And, you know, it's once a week. It's on Sunday. It takes on a little bit of like that church, you know, kind of religion thing. And I had a very, I was fond of all sports growing up. But when I started my professional career, I worked a lot. And I worked until 10 p.m. to close the liquor store. What that meant was I missed an enormous amount of hockey, baseball, and basketball games. And so the Jets, being once a week, only 16 weeks a year normally, because they didn't make the playoffs that often, became very easy for me to maintain and really ascended to the deepest part of my sports heart. And yes, it's a deep passion. I do want to buy them so that I can end the misery. It allows, you know, if I own them, I have control. And that's what I'm looking for.
Well, I want to buy a Bedford Town Football Club. I mean, I don't know how many times you've been to England, but I live in a little town
many
called Bedford.
Times.
Well, I live in a place called Bedford. It's a really small little shit town. You probably won't know it. It's about 40 minutes north of London, but I want to buy them. I think they'll be a bit cheaper than the Jets.
What league are they in?
So, do you follow English football?
Enough to know Premier League. I know that, you know, you get relegated down below. Are they three down, four down?
No, so below that you have the Championship. And then yep. You have League One, League Two, and then you have the Conference.
Yep.
And you have Conference North, Conference South, and then you have about seven more divisions, and then that's Bedford Town.
How many people go to a Bedford Town game?
About 50.
5-0.
About 5-0, yeah.
I love it.
Luke,
I think I want to become a Bedford Town fan. What's the colors? Colors?
Blue. We play in blue. But listen, we won once big. We used to get thousands. We once drew with Arsenal in the cup, but we don't
really?
Have a team. Yeah, we don't have a team. So that's my goal.
Have a few minutes. When did you draw with Arsenal? When were the golden years?
Oh God, let me find that. I think that was like the 80s, or it might be in the 70s. Bedford. Let me look.
So not too long ago.
No, we used to have a decent ground, but it's before me. It was way before. Oh look. Maybe it was like, no, 55, 56. We had a 2-2 draw with Arsenal. We used to have a ground, but we should, the size of town we have, we should have a team. But so that was always my goal, is I'm going to buy them and I'm going to get them in the Football League. And then I'm going to invite you, Gary. I'm going to get you over. We're going to go and watch Bedford play Arsenal.
I'm on board.
Do you like an English team? Is there a team you like?
You know, I like the Spurs a little bit because they've never won. You know, and I like that they haven't won for 40 or 50 years. So 3-4 years ago, I tried to get into them, but I said, you know what? I just love this sport. Let me pick a team that's in the Premier League, but not a perennial winner. Who's like the Jets? Who hasn't won since the 60s? And they had Kane, and it felt right. But then the reality is, the season started where I was going to get very locked in, and my little guy started playing baseball, and I can't be a fake fan. So I gave one try 3-4 years ago to be a Spurs fan. I did not pull it off, so at this point I still am not one. However, I really enjoy the sport quite a bit. I mean, the World Cup has become something that I think about actively as I can't wait for it. And I watch a lot, I invest in it now because I bought an enormous amount of Mbappe rookie cards. I've been thinking about buying up a bunch of Sancho. Like, I'm paying attention more. I can speak lightly to it in a way that I couldn't 5 or 10 years ago. It continues to gain momentum with me. But I would have to say officially today, I'm not. I gave it a try 4 years ago with the Spurs. I did not pull it off. And so I have to officially go with no, I'm not. I'm not. You know, it's a very funny conversation. Similar to Bitcoin, you know, there's things I really understand. And then there's things that I'm like everybody else in other categories where I have an understanding, but I haven't put in the time and effort to really go deep. I know that I would be an incredible proper football fan because I love sports where every match counts. So the structure of the league is incredibly done well. I love passionate fans where people get very territorial and I like to fight. Like, I literally like to fight, like, when it comes to sports. It's the only place that I'm tough, or I think I'm tough. So there's a lot about it that I really like. Similar to Bitcoin, I like the macro thesis of peer-to-peer and decentralization and brand building and just a million different things I like about it. However, the serendipity of my career has never taken me to a place where I've gone as deep as, you know, the conversations that led to us having this podcast. So I appreciate you having me on, and I think it's interesting how those two things tie in, which is they are places of intrigue and surface level and maybe slightly more than surface level understanding. But in a world where I deeply understand a couple of things, it fascinates me when people want to talk about things as experts when they have no idea what the fuck they're talking about. And for me, I tend to try to stay quiet in places I don't know what I'm talking about. Doesn't mean I don't know anything. Doesn't mean, you know, I mean, I bought Bitcoin and Ethereum for nothing, you know, 7, 8, 9 years. I'm trying to think what South by that was, maybe 2016. So was that 15? So maybe, 2015. So, you know, it's not that I haven't touched my AJ, my brother's more actively involved. I thought a lot 3 years ago about building a coin or the thought of personalized, like a reality of like, what if I built a coin infrastructure that gave people access to, like, what if there was a coin for my universe, a small little coin built on top, you know? So I think about it, but I definitely am not deep in it the way I am with communication and content and the New York Jets and sports cards and direct to consumer brands and other things.
Well, listen, look, my background is similar to yours, while not as successful. I had an agency in London once. We did web marketing, search marketing, emails, social, all of that stuff. I got out of that a few years ago, got into the Bitcoin thing. But what I would say is that, let me put a couple of questions to you, and then we'll deal with the basics. Okay. Do you know what the price of Bitcoin is today?
I saw somewhere on my Twitter line 18,000 get tweeted out over the last week. So my guess would be somewhere in that ballpark.
Yeah, yeah. So we're about 18,500. If I said to you there's a very good thesis for why that price within the next 18 months could easily go above $100,000, even $200,000, does that interest you? Does that make you think, oh shit, I should look at this?
You know, let me answer it with a story. At that South by in 2015 when I bought it, in 2016 or 17, when it popped off a little bit, much more than the way we were talking about it in these jam sessions, which is when I would get a bunch of guys and girls together and at South by and we would just talk about the world. I don't remember what the price was, but I remember going around a room with Mark Cuban, Ashton Kutcher, Chris Sacca, fancy internet people. And the question was very simply, would Bitcoin by the year 2020 be $100,000? And disproportionately, the room was said yes. So it's funny that you asked me that you used that exact number, 100K, because that was literally deja vu to something that was a debate 4 to 5 years ago in a hotel room in Austin, Texas. Would it interest me? Less than you would think, let me explain. But sure, of course, you know, nothing, you know, if you're a business person, to me, I would enjoy the getting in and being right more than the dollars associated, not because the dollars are insignificant, because that's a lot of money, and mm-hmm. I would be very excited if I put in $1 million for some at $18,000 a piece and it becomes a hell of, 5x more. I think for me, I've always been, which is why I've never made as much money as I thought, or I think, or many around me think I could. I'm really passionate about loving the way I make my money more than making money. Mm-hmm. So if you told me, Gary, $18,140,000 versus Gary, you buy Pokemon and Sancho and LeBron rookie cards, and you go and you make, for that $18,000, it goes to $27,000. I'd probably like that more. I have not enjoyed making money on my companies that I've invested in privately when they go public. I mean, the amount of money, whether it's Shopify or Snap or Twitter or Facebook, or I've made a lot of money on those products on the stock exchange. I do not gravitate towards public stock, crypto, venture capital. I've come to learn that I enjoy operating.
Mm-hmm.
I like operating, and I like alternative investing that fits my happiness at that moment. But let me say something else. That doesn't surprise me at all. Like, that doesn't seem so far-fetched. It wouldn't surprise me if it's 12.5 either in a year, because I've watched it enough to see that it has its moments, then there's micro step backs. Do I believe the macro thesis of blockchain creates a scenario where Bitcoin, the strongest brand that plays on top of it, can get to that level? That seems very obvious to me as something that could happen.
Well, we should deal with the basics first. I don't think you should ever do a coin. I think you'd regret that.
Yep.
I think your own coin has a reputational issue.
Yeah, not unless it was. See, I think there's a reputational issue in being a personal brand unless you know how to do it.
Yeah.
I think. But let's
all these coins tend to fail.
Yeah, they tend to fail because people are trying to make money off of people.
Mm-hmm.
If you're doing a coin that you're trying to create brand value and create experience and bring more value to the person that holds the coin in actual dollar value than if they didn't. If organizers of a conference had to pay me $150,000 to give a speech, which is what they have to do today, given my speaking fee career. However, I also accepted VCoin, and they actually got me to speak at their conference for what amassed to, tracking it back to 2 years earlier because they were a fan and they bought into it, that it cost them $79 to do that. I think to your point, the reason every coin has failed in the micro is because the person or thing behind it has been financially driven, and they've tried to not bring as much value in return and have tried to, I don't think people know how to build currencies, my friend. They don't bring value.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I think the thing with Bitcoin is proven that they know that with that, in that instance, they know how to build currencies. I just don't think you'll ever get the liquidity behind a coin. Ultimately, people end up selling off. I think they're always fraught with danger. I mean, even Ethereum, the number two.
And by the way, real quick, when I said a coin, let me just create clarity. First of all, clearly I agreed with you because I didn't do it. Yeah, number one. Good. Number two, I think of a coin as a personality, as something that you do very small for a very small group of people, call it 100,000 people, that creates a fun currency within that ecosystem where the human, much like the way I built my personal brand, which was access, actual engagement, if there's actual value exchange, it was more of a fun way for me to disproportionately reward my audience for giving a fuck about me and a way for me to really learn. I never had any thought that I was going to build some fucking real life thing that the world was gonna play on, back to your point, like a Bitcoin. But I did for a while think of, hey, I can really learn this ecosystem. I'm a learner who learns by doing. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know, I'll enjoy learning. And if I can bring people enormous value, like if they were given my coins and then you could buy my K-Swiss sneakers instead for $100, what in essence was free to you, or a dollar, like would I be able to continue to JV with the world, right? Would I be able to do things with brands, conferences, experiences? Would I be able to continue to over-deliver for the people that held that currency? I do believe, my friend, that I think people will create micro realities like that if they are committed to the community, not to themselves, which is a rarity amongst human beings.
Yeah. All right. Well, look, I understand why you would, and we could talk about that, but Bitcoin's the one.
I don't think that's interesting for anybody listening. I think I just randomly brought it up because I was trying to think about things that I've actually been thinking about over the last 7 years that this has been on my radar.
Next up, I talked to Gary more about Bitcoin, but before that, I've got a message from my amazing show sponsors. Okay, we're going to kick off with sportsbet.io. Have you checked them out yet? They've been sponsoring the show for, it's coming up to a year soon. They are the best place for online gaming. And do you know what? They accept Bitcoin. They are such badasses. I love this company. I went over to Estonia last year, spent a bit of time with them, hung out with them, got to know the company a bit, got to know their understanding of Bitcoin and how much they support it. And, you know, they delivered. Look what they've done this year. They've put a Bitcoin logo on the front of a Premier League team shirt, on Southampton's shirt, all around the world. People watching Premier League football are seeing a Bitcoin logo, which is super cool. Now, with Sportsbet, you have every market you could possibly be interested in, from Premier League to US sports. And for new customers, they always have a range of promotions available. Just head over to sportsbet.io/promotions to find out more, and that is sportsbet.io. That's sportsbet.io. Okay, let's move on to Casa. Now, you know Casa. They've been with me for about 6 months now, and they've been with me since I became a customer. About 6 months ago, I was kind of really like on my mind that I hadn't got my Bitcoin security sorted. So I'd reached out to their CEO, Nick, and I was like, come on, man, you got to help me do this. Honestly, ever since, it's been great. So much peace of mind knowing that I am protected from hackers, my own stupid personal mistakes, any in-person attacks, device failures, and so much more. And listen, with Casa, if you are interested, if you're thinking, come on, this bull market's coming, I need to get this sorted, they have a product for every Bitcoiner. So with Casa Gold, you get triple the security of a hardware wallet, and that's at only $10 a month. With Casa Platinum, you get their 3 of 5 multi-sig. That's the best protection for large Bitcoin holders, and that comes at a great price. And with Casa Diamond, you get their full service offering. That includes a customized personal security review, inheritance planning, and of course, their best-in-class security. There is no better time to get your Bitcoin security sorted and total peace of mind. You can find out more at keys.casa, which is keys.casa. And lastly, today we're going to look at Otis. Now, Otis is an investment platform that makes it possible for everyone to invest in shares of cultural assets, from contemporary art to rare collectibles, sports cars, memorabilia, sneakers, comics, and so much more. And this is how it works. You download their app, which is free, and new cultural assets are dropped in the app weekly for you to buy shares in. You can also buy shares of past drops from other Otis members. You then get to earn a potential return if Otis sells the underlying asset for more than the price it was dropped at, or by selling your shares to other Otis members on Otis trading platform. I've signed up and I was checking out their sneaker collections because I am a sneaker investor myself. Pretty cool that they have the 1985 Air One Jordan collection. And also, being a lover of modern art, I love the fact they've got some Banksy work up there too. Now, right now, Otis is offering a free investment share to listeners of the show. All you have to do is go to withotis.com/WBD and sign up to get your first share for free when you fund your account. That's available at withotis.com/WBD. So that is withotis.com/WBD. Yeah, let me tell you about what's been happening this year that's been really interesting. Because I've been in Bitcoin now since late 16. Like, I first heard about it in 13, but didn't really do anything with it. But late 16, early 17, and I went through the spike and the bear market, which sucked. But what's been really interesting this year, what's really been happening, is this cross-section with the pandemic. We've had this cross-section with the pandemic. You know, a lot of people on lockdowns, a lot of companies closing, here in the UK as well in the US, and like rampant money printing by the government to be able to support furlough schemes. And that massive increase in the money supply has this relative risk of we're seeing a potential increase in inflation. So this is a company, do you know MicroStrategy, the data company? Okay, so they're a data company. There's a guy runs that, Michael Saylor. He came out of the woodwork this year. They had $1 billion in their treasury, and he put 450 million of that straight into Bitcoin this year. His thesis being that the money, the dollars he's holding in his treasury is essentially a melting ice cube.
Listen, when paper is printable in perpetuity and not grounded to the gold standard or some other aspect, the thesis is not difficult to understand. Mm. I also think that people are bad at history. There was a time when people traded rocks and other things, you know, money, you know, by governments is not a forever thing. And so people have come along and reinvented currency for a very, very, very long time. I am not educated enough to stand on a soapbox like I am in other things and go deep on this, but as a common sense human being, and that has been my North Star, and as one that believes that humans decide everything in collectives. There was a reason. Listen, I didn't have a lot of money when I bought Bitcoin back then. Like, I bought it for a reason. I didn't follow it through. I really, at least from a financial standpoint, would have benefited quite a bit from following it through. But the macro thesis of blockchain is very right.
Let's say the macro thesis of Bitcoin, not blockchain. The blockchain thing is just like, it's such an unimportant part of it. That's just like one of the tools that... Well, yeah, there's loads of components of Bitcoin that make it work. Well, blockchain is just one of them.
To me, the question becomes if you're saying that, what gets fun is that it becomes a game of, okay, this is now question form, because obviously I come in not as educated as the majority of people listening. For me, then it becomes like, oh, okay, so you're saying this brand is the disproportionate leading brand, which also then speaks to no different than dollar versus yen versus euro, which is, okay, cool. Over the next 50 years of my life, if this plays out, there will be other brands that come along and have the potential to become the leading player. Though this one is so grounded for so long, there's a safety within it. But clearly there's a whole lot of, once this quote unquote cat is out of the bag, there will be enormous 8 billion people's worth of energy to figure out how to establish other brands, because there'll be so much money in the establishment of new brands. That's my question. True or not?
Well, true, because it's already happened. It's been happening over the last 3 years, but they keep failing. Because there's a number of unique things about the Bitcoin brand.
Yeah, but that's no different than what I heard from people about why Yahoo would be the search engine in perpetuity. Gary, you're wrong. I had this conversation in 1999 where I was starting to learn the internet. Honestly, in a weird way, very similar to this. I learned by asking questions from people that know. And I started getting a little nerdy. You know, I was doing the wine thing. Now winelibrary.com is working. I'm like, this internet thing is cool. Let me learn. And I asked some really smart Silicon Valley friends, people that I went to high school with that were out there, nerds, Princeton, Yale, you know, all that good stuff. And I was like, so wait a minute, but maybe I should think about starting a search engine, by the way. Talk about something I definitely was never gonna do. But this was, you know, late night drinks, and you're thinking, this is what's so fun. By the way, that's the most fun, I think, of the Bitcoin and other communities, of like, when there's emerging tech, it's nothing like that. Because there's no feeling like, I mean, literally, this is not a joke. You'll have to explain it for people that are listening. I have goosebumps right now. You see that?
Yeah, I see it.
Because the most fun I've ever had in my life is when new things have happened.
Yeah.
.com, social media. In a lot of Bitcoin. Ways, I should have been really in that Bitcoin game, because it was another big technology shift. Inevitably, VR, AR, other voice, all those things are coming. They're always my favorite, because you're really inventing the future. You're really, you have to think. And I remember saying to my friend, Ken Osowski, I said, there's going to be another search engine. He said, no, Yahoo's too locked in, and others have tried, Ask Jeeves, Lycos, Dogpile, and obviously then it played out. with Google, and very honestly, it's one of my biggest things I've been thinking about lately, which is it almost intuitively feels to me that it's time for somebody to come along and become the next search engine. Like, I can't believe that I'll die 50 years from now where Google was the search engine in perpetuity. I get excited about that. So I think one thing for people that are overly bullish on Bitcoin, and there's a lot of reasons to be, I think it would be crazy to think that there aren't going to be things that come along in the next 20 to 40 years that are on par, if not become the actual brand.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of difficulties with that. And I understand your point. I think because we then had Alta Vista, I remember Alta Vista being the one, and then Google came along. But really, the search engine came down to, did it find me the best result? In the end, if it found me the best result, it's a very easy thing to switch between. Like gold has been the dominant store of value for thousands of years now. And you know, Bitcoin is now taking market share from gold. There's increasingly people moving their money from gold into Bitcoin because it's a better form of money than gold.
The only difference in that scenario is that gold was a physical product. Bitcoin is a brand.
But they're both brands in some way.
Yes, but the ability to replicate, you know, going out right now and saying, hey, everybody, lock your economics into concrete or into tulips, which would be a very good example for historians that are listening, or something else, I would say is a dramatically more difficult, you know, jump from gold in our contemporary society than from somebody, once they understand the ramifications of what you said just now. Mm-hmm. When you think about the economics associated with the statement that what you're alluding to here, which is Bitcoin becomes the standardization, you now have an entire world of governments, trillionaires, you know, Putin alone can start a currency with the amount of money he's hidden. Like you start talking about if it's open, as one would understand it to be, there's just so much rationale to human behavior for many to give it a much bigger try than what I think you've seen over the last 3 to 4 years. You know, when this gets real fucking real, the efforts of trying to establish will be remarkably different. Not to mention, in a world where governments are nationalizing, I mean, look what's going on around the world. You know, we're living through an amazing rise of nationalism, right? Mm-hmm. Brazil, India, America, I would argue, was the tipping point. What's going on in Eastern Europe is reminiscent of the things we saw in the turn of the 1900s. There is a whole lot of government DNA that really doesn't win if this emerges to that truth. And one would argue that for this to go all the way through and become the foundation that many believe it will, there will be an enormous amount of carnage and war that it triggers, which is something to debate and think about. Not from a, hey, let's not support this because it's gonna create war. I would argue humans have done an incredible job as an animal and a species to continue to make it better and better. And I live in a world in my mind where I don't think I'll see it, but if I'm watching down from heaven in 3029 and saying, oh shit, no countries, that's cool. I see how that happened. I can see the chess moves. But I think this is very big girl, big boy talk of what it means for this to become something that is what the world's economics are grounded towards.
Yeah, and you're essentially asking the same questions I've been asking for 3 to 4 years myself. And a lot of it, I was very skeptical and dismissive of at first, but
you know what's funny? You know what's funny, my friend? You know what's funny? I'm going to really nail this point. I hope nobody is confused by my tone and tenor. No. I'm actually remarkably not skeptical or cynical. I would actually argue, if you rewind the last 13 minutes, and especially if you consume my content and know my tones and tenors.
Oh, I know your stuff, man.
Yeah, so then you know this. Then I would say, I don't think I'm actually cynical at all. I actually think this is a wildly fun, thoughtful mind place to go into. I think it's very possible that the most bullish people on Bitcoin's point of view see their day. I also think that if that is true, I think people have not talked about the other side of what happens in a world where if Bitcoin's 200,000, mm-hmm. there's a lot of things that come along with that.
Of course, yeah, man. Look, I've talked about these things.
And by the way, do I think that Russia or America or England, UK, China need to actually exist? I'm being serious now. Do mm-hmm. I believe they need to actually exist? The answer is no, I don't. Like, you know, when people are like, Gary, you know, like, had a good friend, he's like, Gary, you don't fucking get it with Bitcoin. I'm like, bro, I'm not anti-Bitcoin. I'm busy in what I'm focusing about. And like, I'm thrilled if you make a trillion and I make $40. I've never been like currency and central banking. Like, that's just not the stuff that like gets my, like, I want a garage sale and find something for $5 and sell it for $10. Like, I'm not out here worrying about money. It's just not my framework. It's not it. I'm like, I think Bitcoin winning is small in the way that I think of the 1,000 years ahead of us could be. I'm not, you know, because I probably believe in Bitcoin and things like Bitcoin really happening. I'm a complete believer that the printing of money is something people really don't understand. And if mm-hmm. at scale they understand, well, it changes everything. I mean, I hope everybody understands, people fight wars over religion. It becomes ideology. It becomes how you see the world. If 4 billion people just decide Bitcoin's more valuable than money, then it is. It just then is. It's just how humans are, it's how humans work. Mm. And so I actually think Bitcoin is a preview to a humanized reset on what things people believe, because information has always been the most important thing in the world. It's mm-hmm. why books really fucking mattered. The printing press changed everything. And I think we are very naive on how early we are in internet society. And I think that there's a whole lot, These countries are not going to go down and just say, oh, okay. Like I think people are very confused of like the people that are leaders in the world. I promise everybody right now, Vladimir Putin is not going to be like, oh, cool, money's not worth anything. I mean, he's spent his whole life trying to amass all of it. So, you know, I think people have to think through, you know, the social and human ramifications of a $200,000 Bitcoin. But I can see the path. And I definitely do believe that if that becomes true, that the attempts to create another Bitcoin are gonna be far greater than I think most people will realize, because then, like I said earlier, then all bets are off and everybody just goes gung-ho.
But I think the reason those ones fail is for the same reason that Bitcoin exists and it's difficult for governments to attack and switch off. The decentralization, to actually hit that level of decentralization, I feel like Bitcoin is so far ahead for somebody else to actually.
But they're not going to use branded technology. They're going to use weapons. You think a government's going to fight a cryptocurrency versus currency battle with a marketing firm? They're going to fight weapons. No.
But that's a different point. Like
it's the most important point.
Yeah, but that we're talking there. This is talking about, will governments accept Bitcoin and will they attack it? I mean, I think in some ways the US government is accepting Bitcoin because I think it realizes it's a very American idea, and it realizes actually it's something they can't switch
America,
off.
America loves the idea of America when it's in its vested interest.
Well, I think a lot of the Bitcoin's held in America, so maybe it is.
Yeah, but not that's on an individual basis. I think, listen, I love America. I'm so grateful to have lived in America and leave communist Soviet Russia. But I think it's a heady conversation. I think it's a fascinating conversation where I think I'm fascinated when I skim or I read my Twitter timeline or I get involved with a buddy over a dinner who's deep into the space. I don't think the reply from the most powerful, the most wealthy governments, organizations, people that found themselves sitting on cash at the tipping point, I don't think their response is gonna be to build up Ethereum or to like, I don't, I think people are very naive of how the world works. And I think the timing's bad. I think people think the timing's good. I actually think the timing's bad. Let me explain. We are going into garden walls. Just like internet companies are building up their garden walls and not sharing data, Apple versus Amazon versus Google versus, you know, Alibaba and that whole ecosystem, Tencent, I think that governments are doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. We have never, in the last 50 years, been a point in our global society where we have more walls being put up by governments on a daily basis. You know, governments have used these excuses of terrorism to create nationalism at scale. And these leaders will not give up leverage.
Might not have
China
a choice, though.
And Russia and are, yeah, I mean, I think they, you know, I think they do have a choice.
They have a choice to fight it. They might lose.
They might lose. And this goes back to the bigger heady point, which is like, fuck, man, do governments, our countries, to me, Bitcoin is money. I mean, we're talking about a very big subject matter here. We're not even talking about the thought of freedom or money for one person, right? The dictator. We're talking about the whole fucking game. I think that, I think this plays out probably when we're all gone, but I think this plays out with, do countries exist or does it become one world? Because I think money is that big of a foundational conversation in the world. I just don't see China and Russia, and America, by the way, giving up that easily. Because you have to understand, if that's it, everything, it's a complete reset.
Yeah. Well, this is the thing. I was talking about this with a guy the other day. I said, look, there's a reset coming one way or another. I mean, the global financial system is in chaos at the moment. You know, it cannot continue. And the World Bank, I think it was the World Bank or the World Economic Forum came out the other day talking about the Great Reset because there's no money left. But I also think there's a second reset, which is one which is Bitcoin-based, whereby, you know, we're increasingly seeing the gravity of Bitcoin drawing people's money in. And it, you know, one of the big things is, I don't know if you know much about this, but do you know about like the fixed limit, the scarcity, the 21 million?
Yes, I do.
To me, to a lot of people, it all... This is one of the most important things about Bitcoin.
No, it's the reason it's different. Otherwise, yeah. I would sit here and say you can mine in perpetuity, just like you can print in perpetuity. I'm very aware of the restrictions. It's the biggest reason I buy rare sports cards.
I was going to say it's the same thing.
Yeah, it's the same exact. I couldn't be. But again, this is all anybody needs to know. Long before I invested in Coinbase, which was five. Actually, I bought Bitcoin much earlier because I invested in Coinbase. In 2016, I don't know if I have to actually ask, hey, Josh Ellman or Ashton or Aaron Battalion, if you're listening right now, please tell me when we bought. I couldn't even, you know how hard it was to buy it?
Yeah, I do.
I didn't even know how to buy it. I needed my friends to help me, MSG or my brother AJ. I kept it, I have it.
You still got it?
I still got it. That's I don't sell things very often. I still have it, but here's the thing with it. Oh, here's where I was going with that story.
Yeah.
I remember, this is why I just brought this up again. The second I heard the restriction is the second I decided to buy it. I understand. I think my point of view to the community is the word carnage. I understand it. I would actually argue because of probably what has everybody who's listening bullish on it, that it makes sense. You know, I don't think it's some weird cult or some bullshit. I understand, because I mean, why is anything? It's a collective of people just deciding. I mean, I believe in this the fucking most. What I'm not worried about, because I'm not really, I think I established early in the podcast why maybe I'm not as deep. I just don't like money that way. If I liked money that way, let me explain what I mean. I would have started a VC firm, you know, 7-8 years ago and made $20 million a year just to take meetings because of my 2%. Like, I just know myself. And so I'm playing my life. That doesn't mean I don't fully believe in the macro thesis. I do. I just think the more, not fun, the wildly fun, well, I'm gonna use fun again. For me, a man that really loves understanding human behavior and thinking about dominoes and chess, I think the part, and I don't know, maybe this is a major conversation in the Bitcoin community, I'm not close enough to it to know. I think what I believe is, if it's to get to the Holy Grail, whatever one deems the Holy Grail, what the fuck does that mean in the macro? And I just struggle with the transition of governments in this environment, because it's a big, big deal.
Yeah, look, I won't deny that. And I've talked about that.
And unlike, I apologize, one last thing.
Yeah.
And unlike, you know, eBay coming around and fucking up Sotheby's, or Amazon coming around and fucking up, you know, retailers, or Facebook coming around and fucking up MySpace, I don't think people realize it's governments that are gonna react to this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. Like, I would be stunned if Bitcoin hits 200,000 that Russia and China don't ban it and put people in jail for having it. I would be stunned. Yeah. I would be on the record, I'd be shocked if at a, whatever the price and whatever the reason, that Bitcoin crosses that chasm, not some guy putting 450 million in, which is fucking dog shit, into your, you know, huge for Bitcoin, but dog shit in the conversation you and I are having, which is the world's money, right? Mm-hmm. If there is that tipping point, and I live to see it, I don't see any path that doesn't put more than half the world's leaders in a place where they completely ban it, comma, I would argue that America and the EU will do a cute version of it that doesn't look like a dictatorship. And then to your point, my friend, when you whispered, you don't have, they don't have a choice, now you get into the most interesting conversation of how big of a deal this combo is, which is then what?
Whether you play it out, right? So, I mean, China has banned it. Russia has heavily regulated it. The US has...
Yeah, but as you know, because I know both of those points, ish, because it, what they're doing, ish, because they're slightly hedging it enough to think through what they want to do about it. I'm not talking about today when it's still a pimple on the ass in the real conversation of economics. I mean that it's a bigger pimple than it was even 3 years ago. And if it becomes what we're talking about, when you, if it gets to 100, if it gets to 100 in the way that you said in next year, it's gonna be something that Russia and China are gonna be thinking about differently than they do about it today. And the and the question for me becomes, what happens when it hits that moment? Not when you fake ban it, or you watch it carefully, or you fool around with it, or what America does, which is makes it seem like it's getting incorporated. What happens when they actually are scared that the money's not worth anything?
Well, you have to game it out, dude. And that'll probably take us another 30, 40 minutes, 2 hours. And
No, but think I think this is, honestly, this is where I think I can bring, not the most value, but I think it's, Vladimir Putin waking up this morning and realizing the $1 trillion he has hidden is worth nothing, or more importantly, let's talk about it real, is the starting indication of it potentially not being worth something in the next 5 years is not something he's going to take passive.
Mm-hmm. No. Look. Bitcoin has recognized this, Gary. Bitcoin has recognized that.
Educate me.
It is a
so
threat.
What does that mean?
Well, they recognize it's a threat, and so a few of the things they have to focus on is a couple of things: is decentralization.
And who's they?
Like people who work, people who are interested, people who work, developers, opinion people, you know, people who invest in Bitcoin. There's a big focus on decentralization across the board, from developers to nodes to mining, like to keep this as decentralized as possible. You cannot switch off Bitcoin right now, and that's fundamentally not possible right
that,
now.
Which by the way, I'm not confused by that, but you can switch it off when 73% of the countries in the world make it 100% illegal. And you will go and put, you have to understand, this is not trading cocaine. Yeah. This is the whole game. So when China, Russia, Brazil, India say, if you are found in any shape or form to hold this product, that you will go to jail for a minimum of 20 years, it changes things.
No,
And let me say this. There is nothing like it, because it's the whole, that's what I'm fascinated by. In the whole thing, it's so big that there is no comp. There's no missiles. Maybe the only comp was trading the actual information to the atomic bomb, maybe that's the comp, but this is currency. This is the entire oxygen of society.
But maybe this is then the ultimate fight for everyone's freedom.
Yeah. By the way, I'm a buyer of that.
Yeah.
Notice how I've alluded multiple times to no countries.
Yeah.
I just think that's a lot of carnage to get there.
Yeah, but we've went through a lot of carnage to get where we are now, where we need Bitcoin. I mean, global wars that we've had,
By the way, I'm a buyer of that. I think it's a tremendous point.
So maybe this is
I just think that are we ready for global war? And when I say that, I mean like in the macro, it's fascinating. How does that play out individually, right? Okay, it gets banned in the UK. Banned, 20 years. Does your mother say to you, son, please just get rid of it? It gets very personal very fast. We're talking here on a podcast, theoretical. This is real talk, and when it becomes real, what become the conversations? People have lived in dictatorships for many, many years because it's very hard to break them because you need everybody. And if you're the first one, you get killed.
But I guess that has to be gamed out when it happens, because I don't see the UK suddenly very quickly turn around and say, you get 20 years in jail for banning this. I just don't see that happening.
I agree with you on that. I think what you'll see is, I do think you'll see that in China and Russia, Brazil and India. I do. And I think once they do that, what the democracies of the world do is going to be fascinating.
Well, if it becomes international settlement, it puts different pressures on different countries about what they can or will or won't accept. I mean, that's correct. The ultimate goal, that it becomes a global settlement, and then you can't not use it.
I don't think the emerging power in the world is in the benefit of this narrative.
Okay.
The first country to show any banning indication a couple years ago when the momentum hit was China, right?
Uh-huh.
Let there be no confusion. No China on board, no global settlement.
I disagree. I think you can. I think you can. I think if the rest of the world was settling in Bitcoin, they would have to. Now, getting to that point, there's a long way off, and I just don't know
if it will. This is fascinating combo. By the way, everybody's listening, this is stuff I've thought a lot about in the last 5 to 7 years. Almost everybody listening here has probably deeper Bitcoin knowledge than I do. The only thing I've been good at in my life is understanding human behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what I've been focused on this. This doesn't mean that there's not a play to come in at 18, it goes to 47 as it's on its way to this big conversation we're having. You make that transaction, you decide to live your life how you want. For me, I choose to look back at this in 40 years and see how right, how wrong I am. And these are the feelings I have inside of me now.
Yeah.
Because I do think it's a big, big, big deal. It's almost like regulating oxygen. To me, it's the number one thing. And it's fascinating, and I enjoy the conversation. And again, a lot of people are probably hearing me for the first time. I speak with passion. Don't confuse the passion with me thinking I know or I think I'm right. These are my passionate, intuitive, subjective curiosities, just wanted to put that disclaimer out there.
Well, listen, look, I'm conscious of your time, so I don't want to take up.
Let's keep going, though. Let's keep going for another.
Well, listen,
I don't want that to be the.
Well, listen.
Oh, shit! I am late by 10 minutes. You were right. Okay, right, listen, why don't we do this? I'm gonna come off, but since we took up so much of the oxygen in the macro, let's do a part two somewhere here in the next 100 days. And let's jam on it, because I do have to run. I have a finance meeting.
Let's do it.
Ironically.
Yeah. Well, listen, look, I'll reach out to you. I'll drop you an email and we'll fix up the second one.
Cheers.
Okay. So what did you make of that? Did you enjoy that show? It's good to get Gary on. Okay. So this wasn't the show I hoped or expected to have with Gary. It was a little bit hard to steer the conversation where I wanted it to go. And so I've put Gary back in for January. We're going to do this again. I will be prepped for his questions about the response to state intervention. What will happen if Bitcoin does it, $100,000? What happens if specific governments ban it? I will be prepared for that. Look, I know you can't switch off Bitcoin. I know you can't kill it. But, what is the impact if people were, if it was made illegal. So I will be prepared for that. I'll also be looking to talk about a few other Bitcoin subjects with Gary. Hopefully red pill him, get him on Team Bitcoin. Now listen, if you've got any questions about the show, you want to reach out to me, my email address is hello@whatbitcoindid.com. If you want to support the show, just head over to iTunes, leave me a review. That's really helpful for the show's listings. Outside of that, episode 5 of Chaos is coming out on Defiance. That's out on Thursday. And I'm also working on my plans for 2021. Listen, have a great week. Love you all, and I will see you all soon.